Marhaba, and welcome to the Matrix Green Pill, where real people connect.
Hello and welcome back to the Matrix Green Pill podcast. I am Namita Thakkar, and today I'm very excited to welcome our guest of the week, Ankur Joshi, the founder and CEO of Nuclei. Ankur grew up in India and has been a serial entrepreneur for over 10 years. He has worked across startups from varied industries, right from e-commerce to quick serve restaurants and more. But before I give away too much, let's hear from Ankur himself. Hi, Ankur. Welcome and thank you so much for joining us today.
Hello, Namita. Thank you so much for having me on your podcast. It's a pleasure.
So let's get right into it. To start off, can you tell us a bit about your background?
I grew up in a small town called Indore in central India. Grew up in a fairly lower middle class family. So education was our only way out. And that's what my parents were very clear about, that the best gift that they can give to me is to make sure that they guide me to get a better education. Again, to make sure that the financial security, not just for myself, but also for the family, gets secured. Talking about from the Maslow's hierarchy of needs. Post getting that done, I think my parents had to sacrifice a lot in order to give me a good education in the right direction. After that, I think completing my schooling in Indore, I went to IIT Bombay. I also had a job with Deutsche Bank in hand. As a family, we chose to take that opportunity of getting the job and getting some finances going, spending more money to get that MBA done, because we thought we can always go back and that MBA later on as well, which I never went back and did.
Right.
I didn't complete my MBA, which in a way, I think worked out for me, because over the years, having done so many companies, I think that MBA degree came on the job itself.
Absolutely true.
That's grew up there, did my engineering, got into Deutsche Bank. Of course, a lot of nuances I've skipped in between. And then in 2010, decided to leave Deutsche and start up on my own. Did a chain of restaurants for around four and a half years. A tech startup in the pharmaceutical space, building a platform. That's where in 2015, essentially my journey in tech started. So the last eight, nine years, I've been working in tech companies. That startup didn't work out, so shut that down. Joined another startup in Bangalore, built that up over 3 odd years, which got acquired by a big e-commerce company in 2018. Decided that I was a 0 to 1, 1 to 10 guy. Not really. My skill set still doesn't fit well with someone who's working at a very, very large scale, right? So I'm very comfortable in a 0 to 1, 1 to 10 space. Decided to not join and start up again. But this time we were very clear that we wanted to build a business and a sustainable business at that. So decided to completely bootstrap it, not raise any external capital. So there was no pressure of providing any exit to anyone. Decision making was still, you know, within our control, and bootstrap Nuclei since 2018. And over the last 4 and a half years, we have grown across Middle East, Southeast Asia. And now we're also venturing into Europe.
That's how it is, right? I mean, there's no point in having a very clear straight line on your career graph. You need to see those ups and downs to be where you are. But amazing determination and positive attitude, I must say. But this whole journey, Ankur, so obviously you were in a very secure job, so to speak, and then this sudden jump into becoming an entrepreneur. How did that happen?
A couple of relationships there, right? So one is a relationship with risk. And also those two define how you define the definition of success, right? So those three relationships over a period of time have changed for me. The way I defined success in 2007 versus the way I define it today is very, very different. Risk was the first relationship to change drastically between 2006, 2007 to 2010. In 2007, given where our family was, earning money and becoming financially secure was extremely important. Right. As I mentioned earlier, that given Maslow's hierarchy, we were probably in the lowest or rung above. Right. So we were still figuring out financial security. Becoming financially secure was very, very important. Again, I keep using we because it was not an individual decision. Specifically at that point of time, it was always a collective decision. Given the degree that I had, the job that I had, financial security and putting food on the table would be that bigger challenge going forward. So I'm talking about 2010. I realized that financial security shouldn't be a big challenge. We should be able to get through. I can work hard enough to put food on the table. My dad also got that confidence in his own business and started taking more since 2007. His business also started flourishing. As a family, we became slightly secure. You know what? We can take more risk. And that's where my relationship with the risk changed. I started viewing risk as something which is not risky to take or only think about the downside, but think about the opportunity cost. I did not take that risk. The opportunity cost was much higher than taking. For me, taking risk since then, since 2010, has been about not thinking about should I take that risk or not, but thinking about if I don't take that risk, what is the opportunity that I'm losing? That's when that equation with risk changed and the relationship with money also changed over a period of time that I can be financially secure. Should money be the metric which should drive my decisions? And should I work for money or should it be the other way around? I'm not saying that it changed completely in 2010, but over the last 15 odd years, it has gradually moved from me working for money in 2007 to somewhere around 2018, 2019, where money was not the only outcome that I was working for. It a variable into the equation of wealth or, you know, defining success. But it was definitely not the overwhelmingly majority affecting variable. There was freedom, there was time, there was mind space. All those things also became very, very important, probably more important than money. The way you also define success, in 2007, it was all about money. I should be able to earn X amount of money in the year and that's how I become successful, or that's when I would think I'm successful. But over the years, the definition of success has also changed, right? So having my destiny in my own hands was the definition of success in 2010 to now knowing that you don't control your destiny completely. So you sure as a person, I mean, quite honestly, I was a 23, 24 year old in 2010. Did I know? I'm still a fool. I was a fool back then, right? It's just perspective which changes. Definition of success also kept on changing, and it changed from just being money to having quality time on your hand, having the freedom to do a lot of things, having the freedom from doing a lot of things, having mind space. I keep discussing this internally within the family, that with my brothers also, that when you're sitting down with the family at the end of the day to have dinner, are you still thinking some problem you're trying to solve at work? Then you don't have enough mind space to be present in the moment. As you grow in life, as you become more mature, and I hope I have, those things become more important than just having extra zero in your bank account.
Absolutely. Very well said. Yeah, true.
Those are the things, those are the three relationships or definitions which have changed over a period of time. That probably, more importantly, the relationship with risk changed. That's when I started thinking about startups as not the risky thing to do, but actually the less risky thing to do. Because jobs, I would have essentially risked away the time which I have, right? And that's the only resource. So I don't think of startups as the riskier thing to do. Startups as the risk, if I don't take, I would lose out more. Like, does that make sense?
Yeah, of course it does. Still, there would be certain challenges that you must have faced when you started off in terms of setting up the business. Can you talk a bit about that? Like, how did you overcome those challenges?
So one of the biggest challenges and one of the biggest fear which everyone has, and it's human to have, is that what if I don't have money? What if I have to pay my rent, pay my bills, manage my family, right? That's a very, very genuine fear to have. I'm not saying I'm averse to that fear. My dad's friend, when I was starting up in 2010, gave me a single lesson which I stayed with throughout. He told me that if you keep your needs down, then the amount of money which you need to maintain a standard of life will be minimal. Keep that down, then you won't need a lot of money to lead a good life. He also mentioned that the nature of business is that it will always go through cycles, but you shouldn't increase your needs when you are going through an up cycle, because if you have to reduce your needs when you are going through a down cycle, literally your family and your life will break up, because it's very easy to increase your standard of life, but coming down from there is not easy. Maintain it at a minimal level, keep your needs low, and automatically you will have more freedom in life. You will have more freedom to take risks. That particular advice has stayed with me throughout. It just made sure that our way of life was very, very frugal and minimalistic. There was extravagance around it. Does not mean that we don't enjoy luxury once in a while, or does not mean that...
Yeah, but having a balanced approach kind of, yeah, sure.
That advice stayed with me throughout. It's still the way I conduct not just business, but also the way we lead our life. That has been one of the key lessons and one of the core principles, even with nuclei, that we want to remain sustainable, we want to remain frugal, right? So not about overspending, it's about return on investment. And that's what drives our decisions.
Great. So talking about having a risk-taking approach, you know, when you start off or in your business ventures, how do you assess the potential risks and rewards of a new opportunity?
Very complex, very subjective. Of course, your worldview is crafted by your own experiences, right? I mean, you can learn from others, but generally it's your experiences which carry more weight. As you grow in life, as you learn in life, as you stumble in life a lot of times, more than the successes, the failures have defined the risk-taking ability a lot more. The learnings from those failures. Today, as long as something doesn't kill us, and there's a good amount of upside on it, it's a risk taking. I keep discussing this that, you know, it's only in hindsight that you will realize if a particular risk worked out or not. But upfront, it's very difficult to determine. So if you're confident about taking that risk, if there is conviction that you will see it through and it won't kill you, then take that risk. Second mental model to use is that what's the worst that can happen? And it's kind of an extension of the previous one, that if something is feeling good, if it feels that, yes, this is worth it, and the worst is not bad enough, then take that risk.
Right. Go with the gut feeling, basically.
Exactly.
So how do you stay innovative and adaptable in this ever-changing market? Like, what strategies do you use in your business to stay ahead of the curve?
Very interesting question. I have kind of a contrarian view to that.
Mm-hmm.
I would avoid fads. I would avoid flavor of the seasons. I would take learnings from Charlie Munger there, that human behavior hasn't changed. Human still gets attracted towards novelty. Something could be a flavor of the season, but it may not survive the next 5 years. When we are building a business, you can't take decisions on the basis of flavor of the season. That works for the restaurant industry. And of course, being associated makes sense to launch something new every 6 months or having flavors of the season. When you're working in technology, specifically in an enterprise business, you can't keep shifting your strategy every 6 months. So innovation for me personally is thinking about sustainability and thinking about technology or products which can survive the test of time over the next 10, 20 years. It's very easy to get drawn towards things which everyone is talking about or which is receiving a lot of attention in that particular time frame. It's difficult to stay away from those fads. It's difficult to not get attracted towards them and say that, you know what, let's invest there. We have deliberately chosen to stay away from flavor of the seasons. We have deliberately chosen to stick with things which we believe will have a long-term future, next 10, 20 years. And those are the decisions we stick with. So you would not, like if you visit our website, you will not see us talking about crypto. We believe in blockchain technology, but we would still wait for it to mature. We believe there was a lot of hype around metaverse last year.
Right.
Almost every company was talking about, probably we had so many discussions internally that should we do something here and there, but we would want it to become mature as a technology and only then invest in it. Because I believe that's the only prudent thing to do. So it's not necessary to be first in the market. More important to survive the test of time. No one remembers the 17 or 18 other search engines. Probably one or two people remember. It's more Google. But who is the one which has survived the test of time? So again, I'm not comparing ourselves to Google, but I'm saying that that's the learning.
No, but yeah, exactly. The perspective. Yeah, absolutely.
That's the learning which we have, you know, kind of adopted from them, that it's absolutely okay to not be the first entrant, but more important to survive over a period of time.
Very good and different perspective on this. So thanks for sharing that. I'm sure our audience has already recognized the key values you follow, but I would still like to ask you this question. What are some of the key principles you follow when developing a business idea into a successful venture?
That was a question which I was struggling with when we were starting Nuclear, right? Again, I said that we went back to not our successes, but our failures, right? To understand and adopted an inversion principle there, that instead of thinking, how can we succeed? Can we first think about how will we fail? Because if we have failures, the probability of success will increase. These were basically the guiding principles on which we built Nuclei and the key business decisions very early on. And first principle was that we have to think long-term. We have to think long-term, not just about the people we want to work with, people in our team, people who are our partners, people who are our clients, but also with respect to the products we are building, also with respect to the decisions and policies we are building. Policy cannot keep on changing every 6 months. If we are taking a decision to adopt a policy, it needs to be taken with a view. An extension of that is that we are trying to build a sustainable business here. We can't be shifting strategies every 6 months. We can't be building products which will last only 6 months or a year or 2 years, right? We have to products which are more sustainable, which will take a look of 5 years or 10 years, and we'll know that they will still survive after 5 years and 10 years, and then invest into those products. One of the other principle was that if we are investing so many years of our life, these are years of our life and not just few people, right? We are a 120 member team. We are 4.5 years old. If we are spending these prime years of our life, be concentrated. As the CEO, my key job is risk mitigation. I have to identify key risks and constantly, to the extent of being paranoid about it, mitigate those risks. And one of the key risks for me is the concentration risk. You concentrate yourself to a single client or single geography or single product or single industry. How do we diversify as a business, again, to be sustainable and think long-term? Diversifying the business across multiple parameters is something which I'm borderline paranoid about. And that also forces us to think big, because now we are not only thinking about a particular geography, but multiple geographies. When we think about a product, we can't think that will it only work in UAE, or will it only work in Singapore, or will it only work in India? It should work in all geographies, or it should also work in UK. We have to think global. And that again becomes a guiding principle. If you are building something linear, which can only scale up step by step by step, then again, doesn't diversify the business fast enough. Have to start thinking exponentially. That again became guiding principle for us. So there are multiple such guiding principles. And this came from one of my favorite failure. Early on, when I started my first startup, quite honestly, my objective was to be called a founder. There was nothing else. It was purely external validation which I wanted. It was an ego boost to be called a founder. I had no idea about what I was doing as a business. I laugh at the decisions which I made at that point of time. And quite honestly, I was a fool back then. I mean, you are the easiest person to fool, right? I can fool myself very easily. I have to be with myself. Decisions which we took back then just to get that external validation were quite honestly foolish. That's when, the second time around, I was very clear that I will not fool myself. I will only focus on the product. And even if you have the best product in the world, but no one is using it, then what doesn't can't have a business around it? Yeah, we were very clear that, external validation, we don't care about. Product, you can always improve with time. Distribution is something which needs to be solved on day one. So that was something which we were very, very clear that let's just completely focus on distribution, get distribution in place. We can always improve the product as we go forward. But if you have a perfect product and no distribution, it wouldn't matter because no one will know about it. That again became a driving principle, a guiding light that we have to focus on getting distribution first while we are building the product as well. That still drives us that any new product which we launch, we first go in the market, we first figure out where are we distributing it with, how are we distributing it, how do we get that top of the funnel? That's the first thought which comes to us. Why? Because that's something which is more long, that will make sure that it is long term and it is sustainable over the next 10, 15 years.
Being an entrepreneur, and you started off at a very young age, so I really would like to ask you this question, that what advice you would like to give to someone who's just starting out as an entrepreneur? What are the important things to keep in mind when building a new business?
So I would probably repeat the same answer which I just gave, that as the first time, looking back at my own mistakes, first time entrepreneur, I was completely focused on, you say that, right? Sharma uncle calling me as a founder now, right? So that was what was driving me. And it was completely vanity. It's difficult to escape from that. I'm sure almost everyone goes through those cycles. It took me years to come out of that cycle, and be honest with me, myself, I would just recommend people to go through that cycle as fast as possible, whatever ways you can, and be comfortable with yourself that it's okay if, people don't know me. It fulfills you. It's what satisfies you, which matters more. If at the end of the day, you are happy with your own contribution, if you are happy with what you're doing, I think that matters a lot more than what others think about you. Others' opinion about you driving your decisions, it should be the internal feelings and opinions which should be driving the decisions. The sooner someone reaches that stage, the better. I wasted a lot of years learning that. If someone do that in a few weeks or a few months, good for them.
Awesome. Well said. Okay, Ankur, thanks for that. And now we've come to the segment of our show where we'll ask you some rapid fire questions. It's our version of a game show. Of course, as the name suggests, I'll ask you a question and whatever first comes to your mind, you just say that.
Okay.
So who is that one person you look up to?
Writer.
Okay, amazing. And why?
Her kindness.
Oh, nice. Okay, cool. What's your most productive time of the day?
Early morning.
Okay. Your favorite quote? Like a phrase or a quote or even a book?
I'll give you both. So Jonathan Lipsiegel, a book.
Okay.
Favorite quote from, I don't agree with everything which Mahatma Gandhi did or said, but this is great quotes that the nature or the quality of a society, I don't exactly remember the quote.
Sure, sure.
The quality of a society or the behavior of a society gets reflected in how they treat their animals or the downtrodden. That's one of my favorite quotes.
What's your go-to source of inspiration when you're feeling stuck or uninspired in a situation?
The core motivation for me still, which surprises me, but again, I would attribute it to basic human instinct, is that fear of not having money. Like back to mid-90s or late-90s, when as a family, I saw my parents do their best to make sure that I was getting the best education. And I'm not kidding myself, like my parents have enough to last their whole lifetime today, but...
Yeah, but the sacrifices at that time, yeah.
Sense of fear is still what motivates us. That's what is the fire in my belly, still. It surprises me, but that's the honest truth.
Nice. All right. Ankur, before we wrap up, we would like to ask you about your green pill moment. What green pill advice would you give to your younger self?
I took a lot of emotional stress while going through certain challenges in life at various points of time in my life, which in hindsight did not deserve the amount of emotional stress that I took. So if I have to go back or change certain things and how I led my life, I would only say that during those times, I should have taken less stress, less emotional stress. Hopefully, I would have had less white hair then.
All right. Ankur, thank you so much for the time you took to come on the show and share your inspiring journey with us. I'm sure our listeners will have some key takeaways from this conversation, so much to learn from as well. Is there any final piece of advice you would like to share or say something to our listeners?
Always have something fun and interesting to do every day. Everything else, with all things going around in the world, there is a lot of chaos and seriousness which goes on. But if you can remain connected with your childish behavior, at least for moments in the day, I think that will keep the joy in life.
Oh, so well said. Amazing. Okay. So before we say goodbye, can you tell our listeners where they can find and follow you?
Available on LinkedIn, also on Twitter @_AnkurJoshi. And on LinkedIn, I'm easy to find. Just Google Ankur Joshi Nuclei. Yeah, they can reach me out there.
Cool. We're going to put this in the show notes as well. Thank you so much for joining us today, Ankur, and we wish you all the very best.
Thank you so much. It was a pleasure to chat with you. Thank you.
If you enjoy our conversations, please like and subscribe. See you next Wednesday.